John O'Dowd is the Minister of Education for Northern Ireland. Because a lot of young people, including us, are concerned about the future of their schools, we went to Stormont to talk to the Minister.
Mr. O'Dowd, thank you very much for joining with us today. On Hearts and Minds with Noel Thompson, you mentioned trade unions, you mentioned the Catholic Church, you mentioned educationalists, you also mentioned the parents. The one group of people that you failed to mention were young people. Also in referral to St Dominic's and St Rose's, you asked how the pupils benefited from the sharing of resources. So we would like to ask you today, what do you actually do to go out and to talk to young people? Because effectively, you know, you're employed by young people.
Well, you make a very good point, but you have to understand that an interview like Hearts and Minds, I probably have a 10-minute slot to answer questions from a quite interactive interviewer, you know, so you don't always get the points across and fall as you would wish. And one of the reasons why I responded to your tweet was because I think it's vitally important we listen to the views of our young people. So any consultation I'm involved in or any discussion I'm involved in, I think it's vitally important that the views of young people are involved. How do I engage with young people? Through events, I guess. When I visit schools, I go to schools not simply to meet the senior management team, to meet the teachers. I sit down and I talk to pupils. I engage with pupils and ask them about their educational experiences as well, and through other forums as well, whether it be through our local youth clubs, our youth forums, etc., etc. So I have regular engagements with young people, but I'm always open to challenge, and if improvement is required, then we should improve our dialogue with young people.
Do you feel maybe perhaps there's more that you could do to interact with young people? Do you feel like you use, you know, the likes of Twitter and things extensively as they have been used in, you know, with other politicians as well?
I do use Twitter. I've restricted the use of it somewhat since I've become minister because I use Twitter to express my own views and sometimes they can be misinterpreted as me representing departmental or a view, and that can cause unnecessary angst in some corners. I have used a Twitter feed through the department where I have answered and spent over half an hour answering questions on Twitter, and I'm planning to do that again before the end of before the summer recess comes in and the assembly and the summer holidays come in. So I'm always looking for new ways. We're also currently revising the departmental website, and one of the areas I've asked to look at is to ensure that it's young people friendly. Sometimes departmental websites can be somewhat straight-laced, and I've asked for it to ensure that it's young person friendly and young people would feel comfortable using it.
Thank you very much.
Given the fact that middle-class children in grammar schools already have huge advantages over working-class pupils from socially deprived areas, do you not agree that there is a strong argument for giving schools like St Louise's and other comprehensives like ours extra protection from the cuts?
Well, Nicole, I'm looking at a wide range of factors to ensure that there's an equal playing field out there. All the research shows that young people from socially disadvantaged backgrounds are disadvantaged in their educational outcomes. And I'm looking at terms of the common funding formula, how schools are funded, the mechanism on how schools are funded, to see if we can use that in a different way to ensure that we're targeting social need, that the funding is going towards where it is most needed. I'm bringing in an independent review panel to do that. I hope they make that announcement in a number of weeks. And part of their terms of reference is targeting social need. I also have a number of funding schemes through extended schools and other programs which direct funding directly towards areas of social need. Part of the element of common funding formula currently is targeting social need, but I want to reassure myself that we're taking all measures possible to ensure that young people from socially disadvantaged backgrounds are given every opportunity to advance their educational careers.
My question is, as a pupil at St Rose's who is currently studying English literature and politics at St Dominic's, I believe the sharing of resources as one large campus works in theory, but it doesn't always work in practice. Why do you believe amalgamation is a good idea?
I look at education as a public service. I think for too long we've been looking at education on the needs of individual schools. And when I look across Belfast, for instance, and I see two schools right beside each other, I have to ask the question, why have we two schools there? And from a financial point of view, from an equality point of view, I believe that much more work needs to be done across all sectors to break down not only the barriers in terms of religious sharing of education or between the two main communities, for want of a better term, but we also need to break down the barriers in terms of socioeconomic division, which exists in our society. I used St Rose's and St Dominic's as an example on Hearts and Minds in that night because St Dominic's had been in the in the newspapers defending their point of view. I challenge their point of view, and I continue to challenge that point of view. There is absolutely no need for academic selection in our education system. There is no need for selection largely based on socioeconomic background. I believe we can obtain educational excellence and academic excellence in the options of selection.
I'm finishing off with a more controversial topic. As a pupil of St. Louise's, I feel as though a non-selective comprehensive college is brilliant, that every pupil is getting an opportunity to work no matter what their capability, and in a really current environment. Could you comment on the future of academic selection in schools?
Well, the reason why we're sitting here tonight is because I hopefully sparked a debate on the Hearts and Minds show about the need for civic society to come out and make their voices heard on this. And I think the only way we're going to make change in the short to medium term in academic selection is if the churches and trade unions and young people and fellow educationalists come out and demand an end to academic selection. It's an outdated process. All forward-thinking and progressive educational systems across Western Europe and indeed further have abandoned academic selection a long time ago, and their educational systems are actually improving all the time. The educational outcomes for the young people are improving all the time. So for once, as a politician, I'm not saying I'm powerless on this, but what I am saying is we have made many, many changes in the society before when politicians and civic society come together, and I think on this issue, politicians and civic society should come together and demand a change in academic selection.
Okay, thank you. Thanks for taking the time to answer our questions, and we hope you'll have more conversations with young people in the future, and hopefully with us too.
Thank you.